I'm very sorry for this for this delay. So let us go back. Let us go to business immediately. So the title of this last talk is progenitors and host galaxies. We'll deal with the central engine, the prime mover that produces the gamma ray burst, and the galaxies where they occur, the gamma ray burst occur. And we'll also talk about the applications of cosmology and dimensional waves in the near future. So I guess you should already be familiar with this. We know it's what we call the central engine. It is active between, say, 10 to minus 2 and 10 to the 4, 10 to the second. It must produce jet after jet with a burst factor of the order of hundreds, and with a beam corrected energy up to 10 to the 52 Hz. Okay? Its size must be of the order 10 to the 7, 10 to the 8 centimeters. To explain variability in time scales of the order 10 to minus 3 seconds in the light curves. And at least for longer camera bursts, from now on, GRBs, okay, it is associated with a higher nova, or H and E, which are a special class of what called the core collapse supernova. And for short camera bursts, that is, those that last less than 1 to 2 seconds, it does not produce supernova at all, and we have deeper upper limits for it. Okay, central engine must obey all these characteristics. To get more clues about the central engine, let us take a look at the hypernova associated with longer gamma ray bursts. These are 100 times more luminous than your typical core collapse supernova. Okay. They have 100 times the standard kinetic energy of core collapse supernova. They have 100 times the amount of radioactive nickel-56 that powers supernova light brightness. Okay, and they expansion speed is 10 times the usual expansion speed of core collapse supernova. Indeed, there are sources that expand so fast that their typical emission and absorption lines in the spectra are very broad. They call them broad lines sometimes. Okay, yeah. And by inspecting the spectra of objects, they found that their geometry is actually bipolar. Bipolar means that it's not a sphere, but it is elongated along an axis. Okay? We know this because we have studied, as I said, the spectrum. See, if we studied the nebular spectrum of a hypernova, and we have seen that, for example, for those supernova associated with gamma ray burst, the oxygen lines, okay, are narrow. Whereas for the same hypernova, but those that we think are not seen on the axis of the jet, so they don't produce gamma ray burst. For this object, the oxygen lines are broad, meaning that there is material which is coming very fast towards the observer, and material which is going very fast, which is running away from the observer. There are other characteristics in the spectra that indicate that hypernovae are actually not spherical, are not isotropic explosions, but they have jets. Okay. Finally, there is no hydrogen, no helium in the spectrum. No gamma ray burst supernova has ever been found to have hydrogen or helium in the spectrum. Okay. People have worked out with the spectrum. They thought maybe the helium and hydrogen are hidden in the, there's a very broad lines. Maybe there's a bit, but it's not visible. Maybe the helium does not mix with the radioactive nickel, so it does not get excited, it's not visible. All of this does not work. There is no hydrogen or helium whatsoever in the spectrum of Astronomy, associated with gamma universe. It tells you that somehow the mechanism that produces gamma reverse is also linked to the removal of hydrogen and helium in these objects. Okay? And Schuder said there are 1C broad lines supernovae or hypernovae that show realistic ejecta but have no gamma ray emission detected. And Schuder said these are the kind of example. 2003 JT. It had realistic material, but there was no gamma ray emission associated. And it showed this broad line, this W peak in the oxygen in the oxygen lines. All these characteristics cannot be explained assuming that the supernova explosion mechanism is neutrinos, okay? You know that core collapse supernovae are supposed to be powered by neutrinos. That the core collapses, it produces a huge amount of neutrinos, and these neutrinos somehow manage to drive a shockwave along in the star and make it explode. This you cannot do this. We cannot use neutrinos to explain its properties. We think that these objects are so-called engine-driven supernova. Neutrinos are not enough. You need a source of energy in the core of the star, which we call an engine. And we also think that there is a continuum of properties between core collapse and supernova and the reverse supernova. You see, this plot is kinetic energy versus the ejecta velocity. It tells you that for this object, the standard core collapse supernova, the kinetic energy is mostly associated with slow moving ejecta. Okay, if this gamma beta here, this is the speed of the ejecta. If it's larger than one, then you have a realistic ejecta. If below, it is not realistic. This plot tells you that most of the energy for collapse supernovae, standard for collapse supernovae, is associated to very slow moving ejecta, less than 10% of the speed of light. There are some fast moving material in core collapse supernovae, but they have a very tiny amount of energy. Okay? For gamma reverse, here, the red dots, instead, there is a lot of energy in a non-relativistic ejecta, see the red points here, but there is a lot of energy in relativistic ejecta as well, with Lorentz factor over few tens. Okay? This is what this plot is telling you. But there are also some transitional events in which the 10 to 50, the usual 10 to 52 Hz in slow moving ejecta, but there is about 1%, say 10 to 50 Hz in mildly relativistic ejecta. Okay, with Lorentz factor of the order of 1, 2, something like that. And these are the realistic 1CBL hypernova I just mentioned in the last talk. These are so-called low luminosity gamma reverse. We don't have time to talk about them, but they are similar objects. And we think that they mark a difference. This diagram is telling you something about the center energy and the jets. Remember, gamma reverse have jets. Okay, the supernovae are affected by the presence of these For these objects, we think actually the standard for collapse supernova, we think that there is no jet, or if there is a jet, doesn't manage to escape the star, okay? Doesn't make it to the surface of the star. For gamma ray bursts, for standard gamma ray bursts, the jet, we see it, is actually created, and it also can escape the star and produce gamma ray bursts, as we see them. These are objects, these transition objects, we think they are, we think that we have weak jets that just manage to escape the star, okay? Now, we know that there is a jet drilling its way to the star. The jet starts at the center of the core of the star and makes it to the surface. Okay? It will take some time. The observed duration of the gamma ray burst in 90, the time where 90% of the photons are collected, will be equal to the ending time, that is the time when the center energy is active, minus Pb, which is the time that the ending takes to drill to the star, the breakout time. Okay, by simple mathematics, we derive that the distribution of the 90, which is the derivative of the distribution, the derivative of the number of gamma first over the 90, será equal to will be equal to the probability that the center energy has a total duration of T90 plus Tb. Okay? So the center energy must stay active for at least this time. But if you take this probability that the center energy is actually lasting, is working for at least this time. But this also means that when T90 is much smaller than the breakout time, okay, this T90 over Tn over T90 will be simply equal to P probability that the central engine has a duration which is actually the breakout time. So if you assume that this quantity is constant, okay, the probability that the engine works for exactly the time of the breakout time, then you should see a plateau, a flat distribution in the T90 distribution. Okay? Remember, T90 is the duration of gamma ray burst emission. If you look at this curve here, the distribution of n is a function of T90, okay, and you see no plateau, no flat, anything, nothing. The reason was we were looking at the wrong representation. You should not look at this plot here is d log n over T90 over T90, okay? But you should look at something different. You should look at what happens for, you should not look at the log diagram, because this formula here, see, does not use the logarithmic values, okay? So actually the plateau is there. This is the distribution of duration of T90, should say. The n of T90 versus T90. And here it is, your plateau. This means that for this region of the diagram, the probability that the engine is lasting about the probability that the engine is working for is actually TB is constant. Okay? And as we said earlier, this is TB is the time the jet takes to drill to the star. And for this diagram, you can find TB is 25 seconds approximately. Okay? This is the time that the jet takes to drill to the star. 25 seconds. This information was buried the light in this distribution of duration versus time. So the distribution of number of gamma bursts versus the duration. But we have never seen it. An important consequence of this study, however, is that if the central engine lasts less than these 25 seconds, then the jet will not escape. We die inside the stars. These are going to be defined chocked jets. The dark side inside the stars. But they still should be able to make that bipolar expansion. Okay? Or to make those low luminosity gamma ray bursts or relativistic supernova. Now, the basic physics of central engine, it must be a compact object. Why? First of all, there is the viability, the time viability argument. It must be 10 to minus 3 seconds, remember, so it must be compact. Second, to produce 10 to 53 Hz, you have to release the gravitational energy of about one solar matter, approximately, onto a very small compact object, on the order of 10 to the 7 centimeters. Okay? This is the only way to produce 10 to the Hz. So the candidate for gamma ray bursts and the engines are uniform stellar records in the stars. These are the only objects that fit this topic. So you have accretion rates, so you have these very large stars. For example, in the case of longer gamma ray bursts, you have these very massive stars whose core collapses into a black hole or the star. Okay? If you have about a solar mass which is dumped onto these compact objects in about 100 seconds, a typical duration of the gamma ray burst, then you have accretion rates of the order 10 to minus 2 solar mass per second. The temperature and densities will be so high that photons cannot escape. Only neutrinos cool the system. The energy is lost only thanks to neutrinos. Gamma ray bursts are one of the few cases in which we have so-called neutrino cooling. And the cross-section for neutrinos to interact with baryons, leptons, is much less than that for photons. So you remember the Eddington luminosity, it's the maximum, it uses the luminosity for a source which is hitting at the maximum rate. The maximum rate is dictated by the fact that photons repel the hitting matter. Now you have to rewrite this Eddington luminosity for neutrinos. And you can do it, of course. And the luminosity, Eddington luminosity for neutrinos in the order of 8, 10 to 53 x for an accretion rate of one solar mass per second. Okay? Working with Eddington luminosity, you can derive also the temperature in this region, which will be of the order of 50 mega electron volts. The typical densities, which will be of the order 10 to 11 grams per cubic centimeter. The magnetic fields, using some rough equipartition, which will be of the order 3 10 to 16 Gauss. Okay? It's very important, 3 to 16 Gauss. It's telling you that this collapse can make manifolds. Okay. Now, all these conditions are never reached in active galactic nuclei or X-ray families, because these objects are bound by the dental luminosities for photons, which is much lower than dental luminosities for neutrinos. Okay. Now, the core of the gamma ray progenitor collapses into a black hole or a neutron star. Okay. So you expect the formation of an accretion disk around this object if the inflowing material is as high enough angular momentum. Okay? No surprise here. However, the parameters of this disk are very different from everything we have studied so far. As opposed to so far, we have studied accretion disks in AGN, we studied accretion disks in X-ray binaries, which there is a neutron star or a black hole. But these accretion disks are very different objects. Okay? They are very different objects for the parameters I will just show you, but also because they are not cooled by photons, but they are cooled by neutrinos. Okay? Indeed, we say neutrino dominated accretion flow, NDAF. Angular momentum, like in other accretion disks, okay, is a basic parameter of accretion. I'm sure you have studied accretion disks and you know that angular momentum is just everything. Okay? It is transported outwards via a sort of viscosity, which is described by the famous treatment by Shakura and Suyanov, 1973. Not wrong. This viscosity governs the accretion rate. Okay? The higher the viscosity, the longer the material will take to accrete onto the central object, and vice versa. And if this governs the accretion rate, it also governs the ratio between the velocity, the matter which is flowing onto this disk, and the free fall velocity, and this is alpha h over r squared, where h is the height of the disk, and r is the radius of the disk, assuming thin disk. Okay, this is the standard treatment by Shakura and Suyanov. But the parameters, as I just said, in physics. It's very different, okay, for the reason I just said. There are, however, similar phenomena going on. Now we have the disk, but how do we make the jet? Can an accretion disk and a black hole inside a massive star power the jet? How this can happen? The problem is that we don't even know exactly what is power here, what is created. Is it the jet made of baryons? Is it the jet made of pairs, E plus E minus? Or is it dominated by quantum flux? I hope you remember from the last lecture that we still don't know whether the jets are populated by baryons or the quantum flux dominated, for example. However, this is a very hotly debated topic in gamma ray burst physics, astronomy. Broadly speaking, there are two possibilities. The jet is powered by neutrinos wind, okay? Neutrinos and antineutrinos cool the disk. Okay, the disk is like that. This disk produces a lot of neutrinos, and neutrinos and antineutrinos can annihilate perpendicular to the to the disk and produce E plus, E minus pairs. Okay? This will be powered by this by energy, at least in this system. However, these days we think that this system is highly inefficient. Okay? Another possibility, which is these days is the favorite one, is that the jet is launched by a magneto, an electromagnetic effect, the so-called Blanford dynamic mechanism. Okay? I don't know whether we have studied the BZ, the BZ mechanism, but it's very important because it basically explains, for example, jets in AGM. It offers a good explanation for jets in AGM and X-ray binaries, high energy binaries. Okay, we think that the accreting compact objects, for example, a black hole here, acquires a magnetic field B and a difference of potential, which is of the order of 10 to 22 volts, between the poles and its equator. Blanford and Dynamics have shown that you have a rotating black hole immersed in a magnetic field. Okay? That black the surface, the event horizon of that black hole will act like a membrane, and this membrane will have a very strong, incredibly strong difference of potential of the order of 10 to 20 volts between poles and equator. So the plasma will be accelerated to huge energies, okay, and magnetic field lines, which will be, however, wound up by the rotation of the black hole. Changing a bit is the same story that happens in pulsars. Okay. Ultimately, the source. This wound up of the magnetic field lines is what also managed to confine the jet. Okay. Ultimately, the source of jet energy is the rotational energy of the compact object. Okay. And the black hole has a lot of rotational energy, of the order 10 to 53, 10 to 54 hertz. Okay. And the Blanford-Dynamic mechanism managed to extract this kinetic energy and rotational energy and power the jet with an efficiency of the order of 5 or 5-10%. So it is enough to make the energy of the jet. Okay. Another possibility that has meant a lot of interest these days is that the jet launch mechanism is not what it has shown, but it is the bipolar radiation from a newly born magnetar. Okay? These days, we measure magnetars with speeds, so the rotational period of the order of the second. Okay? But it is plausible to assume that magnetars were born inside the massive progenitors with P, with periods of the order of milliseconds. Okay? And this way, the mass have emitted a hell of the polar radiation. Okay? Think of this magnetic dipole of 10 to 50 with magnetic fields of the 10 to 15 Gauss, okay, rotating with up to 1 milliseconds. Okay? This is the luminosity that we expect. Function magnetic field, period and radius on the star. The energy reservoir here is the rotational energy of the magnetar, which is expected to be a few 10 to 52 hertz. OK? okay, for typical parameters of the newborn mantle. So enough, it is enough to power a gamma burst. Luminosity is roughly this energy, this envelope, divided by a certain, the time scale is the time scale of, over which this luminosity is emitted, is this energy, this envelope, divided by this luminosity. Okay? And it is roughly constant. And so around this time scale, tau, okay, beyond which it decreases as time to minus 2. If you compute this tau, this time scale, you get that it is of the order of a few hundreds. Okay? So you meet the requirements for energy, and you meet the requirements for duration. It's not clear whether Mariter can produce jets, coordinated jets, like the black hole can. Okay? Now, somehow, the jet drilled its way to the star. In long gamma ray bursts, remember, there is a 10 solar mass star. Okay? And you may wonder, but how the hell, or how in the heaven, can we make, can we create especially key relativistic jets moving in a 10 solar mass star? It's awfully difficult, because relativistic jets decelerate for just a tiny amount of matter in front of them. Okay? Here we have an awful lot of matter, we have 10 solar mass star. We think that if the jet is powered long enough to emerge from the star, this can happen, but I think I have to tell you that it's very complicated. We need people to investigate this subject with simulations with very huge computers, okay? With mainframes. And these simulations change parameters of the jet, such as energy, luminosity, opening angle, duration, and we don't know exactly whether the confinement of this jet into a narrow beam, okay, is produced by the magnetic field B or the surrounding cocoon of hot matter around there. Take my word that it's very difficult to make jets in such a condition, because without going to mathematics, the matter of the star will try to choke, to kill the jet. Okay? There will be shock waves moving back and through that will try to kill this jet. And if a central engine does not produce the jet at constant rate, okay, the jet is doomed. There are instabilities in this plasma flow of the jet that also makes life difficult. Also, this jet, in a hypernova spectrum, the supernova spectrum of gamma ray bursts, we see 0.1, 0.5 solar mass of nickel. It is possible that we don't know whether shock waves at the head of this jet, there will be a very strong shock wave. It's possible that the shock wave makes an explosive nucleosynthesis and produces this jet. Or perhaps this nickel is produced at the base of the jet, and the jet is just dragging onto the surface. But there is this nickel in this. Remember the plot of the star. Of the hypernova. People that study these simulations use also change the mass, the radius, the density gradient of the star. Okay, the density of the star will decrease with the radius. This is the meaning of the colors here. Okay. But we actually don't know the density gradient of in a very massive star at the end of his life. However, something is telling you that the jets do not want hydrogen and helium. The fact that we do not see hydrogen and helium from spectra indicates that if the star keeps this very thick envelope of hydrogen and helium on the surface, then the jet cannot escape. Okay? It is trapped inside the star. Now here is a simulation. Let's see if it works. So here we have this very massive star at the end of the its life. You look at the core. Nuclear reaction stops. The core collapses into a black hole. Matter starts to flow, creating the fission disk. The system black hole and fission disk produce these jets. Finally, emerge from the star. And if you're looking at the star, if you're looking at the jets head on, then you see the gamma reversal. In all this picture, as I said earlier, angular momentum is essential. Okay? Why is it essential? Well, you need angular momentum to make the fast rotating compact objects with enough rotational energy. Okay? You need the angular momentum to make the disk that must live for at least 25 seconds, probably much more, say 1,000 seconds. Okay? We know that the central engine stays active for 1,000 seconds now. You also need angular momentum to keep the ejector confined within a narrow beam. You must make the magnetic fields rotate to make this jet. Theoreticians will tell you that you need an angular momentum, or density angular momentum, with the order 10 to 16 centimeters squared per second. Okay, we think. Let us take a massive star and see whether it can keep this J, this angular momentum, till the end of its life. Problem is, and believe me on this point, the evolution of very massive stars is far from assessed. Okay? It's far from known. Many effects, such as stellar wind, binarity, many of these stars are binary, gross binaries, internal mixing of the star, of the material of the star, magnetic torques between the core and the star envelope seem to play a role in the final configuration, the final outcome. Now, very roughly, there are two classes of long-member reverse progenitors models. The first class is a single star. However, single star have this problem. Very massive stars, as you know, have a very strong stellar winds. Okay, and the stellar winds take away angular momentum from the star. Now, the higher the metallicity of the star, the higher the mass lost, that is the stellar wind. Okay, because ions are mostly sensitive to the photon pressure. Okay, so to keep angular momentum of the order 10 to 16, you need metallicity Z lower than a certain metallicity threshold of ZPH. On average, there are several models, but on average, you need a metallicity less than 1/3 solar. Okay? Evolutionary models show that if you have a single massive star, it has metallicity which is equal to solar, okay, it will not rotate at the end of its life, regardless of how fast it rotated at its birth. Okay? And of course, you cannot make a gamma reverse if the star is not rotating. Note, some stellar wind, okay, is still required, is still needed, because you have to remove the hydrogen and helium envelope, the standard hydrogen helium envelope, okay? Or you can consider another class of models, the so-called binary, to understand that there is a very fine tuning here. If you have too much standard wind, you kill rotation. But if you have no standard wind, then you do not remove hydrogen and helium envelopes. Okay? This is one reason why these models are not favorite these days. Or you can have a binary star. Why do we consider binary stars for progenitors of gamma reverse? Well, first of all, 90% of all type stars are binary. Okay? Second, if you have binary stars, the angular momentum is not just the angular momentum of one star, but it is also the angular momentum of the whole system, of the two stars attacking each other. So tides between the stars and even mergers, two very massive stars, can actually merge in their lifetimes if they are close enough. It means that one third of massive of all type stars in the sky are the result of mergers, okay? Of two smaller stars. So tides and merge may provide enough angular momentum to make a gamma reverse. So if there is this additional source of angular momentum, you don't need a metallicity very low, okay? So the metallicity threshold is much less. We think is of the order 0.9 of about solar metallicity. To understand exactly what this metallicity is, let us take a look at longer gamma reverse of galaxies. I hope you remember that I showed you this picture earlier. Okay, shows a collection of GRB of galaxies. Okay, before Swift, we thought that all those galaxies were small, irregular, interacting with high star formation rate, and as a consequence, okay, of being small, they had a very low metallicity of the order of 1/10 solar. Okay? So you may think, okay, this favors the low metallicity threshold scenario, okay, because progenitors of gamma reverse must form from the repeat of these galaxies. These galaxies have low metallicity. Okay? You think that this scenario is actually the right one, no metallicity, so single star could actually work. Wrong. It was a classical conclusion from a biased sample. Before Swift, gamma reverse of galaxies were identified if the gamma reverse had an optical afterglow. Okay? This was your only chance, because Deposax X-ray telescopes, Deposax the main telescope before Swift, okay, had a resolution of the order of one arc million. This is too much to identify the host galaxy. You need an optical afterglow to identify the host galaxy. Okay, you see optical afterglow onto the galaxy. Problem was, only 10% of gamma reverse, long gamma reverse, had an optical afterglow to those days. 70% did not have an optical afterglow. Okay? So we were making conclusions with only 1/3 of the total sample. Okay? This 70% of gamma reverse without an optical afterglow remained dark. Gamma reverse, a good name. So, however, the problem was even worse. Not only you are you are excluding two terms of the sample, dark memory bursts might represent events where there is a lot of dust, okay, which extinguishes, which kills light, which extinguishes light, okay. So if there is a lot of dust, what's your conclusion? There may be lots of metals there, but we are not considering these galaxies. The dark members host galaxies could be richer in metals, but before Swift, we were not including the need of X-ray emission. X-ray emission is 99% of cases. You can study dark gamma bursts and optically bright gamma bursts alike. So different international groups have launched systematic study of gamma burst hosts, observing X-ray error boxes of all Swift gamma bursts, not only those that have optical output. The studies identified the host galaxies and studied the properties via photometry and spectroscopy. They found a lot of information about sample luminosity, size, extinction, validity, star formation rate in these galaxies. And we used measure of sample facilities such as the Very Large Telescope, Gemini, Keck, Spitzer, just to name them a few. We have collected huge amount of data on the host galaxies of gamma bursts, and this is the picture. This is the absolute magnitude of gamma burst host galaxies, and this is the ratio. Okay? Brown objects are dark gamma burst host galaxies. As you can see, are bigger because they are more luminous. They are dustier, they have a higher extinction, and they are redder than non-dark gamma burst hosts, which are the green points here. Okay. This is the average. This is the average luminosity of dark gamma burst hosts. This is the This is the average luminosity of gamma burst hosts galaxies. Okay. You can see more brown points, which are extinguished galaxies of gamma bursts, that is dark gamma bursts host galaxies. Okay? Here, as you can see, there are more objects which are extinction free. Some dark gamma bursts host galaxies are bigger than the Milky Way itself. Okay? For example, this object here. Three times the solar mass of the Milky Way. However, on average, long gamma burst host galaxies are still smaller than the typical star forming galaxy at the same redshift. The gray circles here are the average star forming galaxies at given redshift. As you can see, this is the average, okay? The average of the average galaxy of gamma burst is still less bright than less luminous than the average star forming galaxy at given ratio, which is given by this line here. Okay? However, true, but notice this point here. There is a lot of star formation rate at low ratio, okay, in bright galaxies. There is a lot of star formation here in bright galaxies at low ratio. But there is no gamma burst host galaxy, either be it dark or optically bright, redshift less than one. Okay? So gamma bursts select objects with objects of small mass on average. Okay? Then by probability arguments, you can see that the probability of obtaining a gamma burst drops almost to zero, not set to zero, but almost to zero, if the luminosity of your host galaxy is above this red line. This luminosity is a luminosity threshold. Okay? But if you have a luminosity threshold for gamma ray bursts of galaxies, you also have a metallicity threshold. This is the metallicity versus mass of gamma ray bursts at different levels. Okay? So there must be a metallicity threshold for gamma ray bursts. It happens to be the same at all redshifts. The true luminosity, if you consider here, if you take the luminosity threshold and you infer the metallicity threshold from here, you always derive the same metallicity. These are for the order of solar metallicity. Okay? This result has been confirmed by spectroscopic analysis of host galaxies. Okay? So far we only have photometry. Here we have spectroscopy with host galaxies. Okay? And this recent paper shows the following. This is a metallicity versus mass of the host galaxies at different directions. This line here shows solar metallicity. Okay? As you can see, there are no hosts above solar metallicity. Okay? We have lots of hosts up to metallicity 0.7. 0.7 is about here. But we do not have any host galaxies above solar 0.7, 0.8 solar metallicity. This plot here, this is a so-called metallicity, mass metallicity plot. This plot here, instead, is metallicity versus mass minus star formation rate. If, again, there seems to be a threshold here for host galaxy gamma ray bursts above 0.7, 0.8, there are almost no host galaxies. Okay? This group is the fundamental metallicity plane, FM plane. I don't have time to go into details, to describe it, but again, it gives you the same result. No host galaxies for metallicity above 0.7, 0.8, something like that. Now, we have this metallicity, 0.7 is one solar mass, 0.7, one solar metallicity. Okay? So the models for binary stars will be more appropriate. But it's more important to understand at this point what we can do for gamma ray bursts. When the metallicity of all galaxies of the universe was below this metallicity threshold, okay, then gamma ray burst rate simply followed the star formation rate. Okay? It means that the gamma ray bursts are a good indicator of star formation rate at redshift larger than 4. That is when the universe was young enough that all the metallicity of all galaxies was below this limit. Now, gamma ray bursts of galaxies are not biased for luminosity. While high redshift galaxy surveys probe only the bright end of luminosity distribution, gamma ray bursts are incredibly bright. I hope you got the tip by now. So gamma ray bursts can be detected up to redshift 20. Okay? So far, they've been found up to redshift 9.4, but they likely occur at even higher distances, where they may be produced by even by collision three stars, the first metal free objects formed in the universe. For all these reasons, gamma ray bursts may be the only probe to gauge to study the birth of the galaxy population at high redshift, study their star formation rate, study their environment, and possibly find population three stars. This is the reason why gamma ray bursts these days are called tools for cosmology. Now let us take a look at a short gamma ray burst. So far we talked about low gamma ray burst, but what about short gamma ray burst? We want to take a short break, so Right, in this second part, we talk about short camera flares. The mostly applies to long duration camera flares, but now we talk about short. The sensor engine of short camera flares should still be a black core duty star, but it's important in different conditions. This was clear from the very first number of detected short camera flares detected by speed to 55998. It was the error box of the object. You can see the host galaxy, because this is the host galaxy, it's too bright to be there by chance, was an elliptical object. Okay? So it is passive. It has no star formation. No young and massive stars whatsoever. Okay? And it also has a low vision reflex. Okay? Lower than typical reflex camera person. Throughout the years, we have studied a lot of camera bursts of galaxy by thanks to speed, by photometry and spectroscopy. And we now have fairly good idea of short camera burst host galaxy populations and what they tell us in terms of camera burst, short camera burst progenitor. So you can see actually a large number of host galaxies of camera burst, short camera burst, are not forming galaxies. Okay? Only 15 of them occur in elliptical galaxies. Most of them are hostless. There is no galaxy in the nearby or the camera burst afterwards. Okay? And some of them are unclear cases. These are the general properties. The blue dots are long-duration gamma reverse. The black dots are short-duration gamma reverse. This is a star formation rate versus redshift, as you can see, also short camera burst of galaxies have lower star formation on average. They also have an older star population, as you can see from this plot here, short and long, so they're older objects. They have a higher metallicity. Okay, versus longer camera burst. They also have higher mass. Again, short and longer. But the most important of error, short camera burst present very large offset from the host. This is the cumulative fraction of offsets. This is for longer camera burst and for short camera burst. As you can see, short camera bursts occur much farther away than the center from the center of the host galaxies than the longer camera bursts. And as I mentioned earlier, short camera bursts occur at low redshifts. We don't see short camera bursts at high redshift. One half of all short camera bursts are allocated at this answer should be minus, okay? Redshift less than 0.7. So typical age of the universe then was about the average for the universe, age of the universe was 7.7 gigahertz. Basically, this plot here shows the expected redshift distribution of gamma reverse, assuming that the progenitors are stars that form the following the star formation rate of the universe, which peaks at redshift 2, but with a delay tau. And the best fit to the data say that if you assume that this delay tau is 3.34 gigahertz, Then indeed you can explain the redshift distribution of short gamma reverse. Let me repeat, we have most of the progenitors, stellar objects that are born at redshift 2 when the transformation rate of the universe was the maximum. If you insert this delay of 3 or 4 gigahertz, then you can explain why short-term reverse occur only or predominantly slow ratios. Some clues came from short-term reverse afterglow modeling as well. You see here again cumulative distributions of density and kinetic energy, assuming anthropy for short resonant reverse. There are a number of assumptions here, but the take-home message is that the typical densities are on the order of 10 to minus 2. On average, the densities for the environment for long duration gamma reverse are 10. Okay, here it's 10 to minus 2. The density of the environment, short gamma reverse, is much lower. Also, the energy is much lower, of the order of 10^51 versus 10^56 for long duration gamma reverse. So, let us gather on the views here. All galaxies of short gamma reverse have a low, sometimes zero, transformation rate. High metallicity, all stellar population. The environment of short duration gamma reverse is characterized by low density. Okay? Short gamma reverse often occurs very far away from the host. This is an agreement with this previous point. Okay? Because if you are very far away from the galaxy, the density is very low. But this large distance between the short-term reverse place where the short-term reverse has occurred and the host galaxy tells you that the progenitors must have traveled a lot from their birth places. Okay. It's also in agreement with the fact that about one third of short-term reverse have no host galaxies, because they have traveled so far away that we cannot recognize the host galaxies anymore. And finally, but last but not least, short-term reverse rate is consistent with universal formation rate history if one assumes a delay of 3 gigahertz between formation and explosion. And do not forget, progenitors of gamma or short-term reverse must still be compact objects. Okay? So the main suspect, okay, is neutron star, neutron star, and black hole matters. Because from the formation of binary neutron system until the final matters, gigahertz can pass by. When you create a system of neutron star, black hole, gravitational waves takes gigahertz to make the orbit shrink and finally collapse. This is okay for low and high energy transformation hosts. If the progenitor formed billions of years before, then you can have whatever transformation rate in your host galaxy. Of course, you can also have all stellar population. Okay? And especially okay for the gigahertz delay with respect to the peak of universal formation rate. Binary neutron stars are survivors of two supernova kicks. Okay? We know that supernova give supernova kicks to the neutron star or black hole they form. You have here two supernova kicks, So you can expect that this system, this binary neutron stars, can travel a lot, okay? Because they have very high speed, and it takes giga years for them to merge, to collect into single objects. And this is okay for large objects and low density for the environment. So here is a movie, shows you statistically what is supposed to happen when two neutron stars finally merge. And less statistically, I can tell you that in the last years, people have run a lot of heavy simulations that try to describe what happens in neutron stars when they finally merge. It's a pity that this figure is small. I will try to make it bigger. Let's see if it works like that. People have taken two little stars with their parameters. Magnetic fields are shown in lines here. So when you start finally merge, what you've seen, what is born out of this simulation, is that magnetic fields create atolls. Okay? And you can make jets out of these atolls. How this field lines, just like happened for the black hole in long duration gamma bursts. But it took a very powerful computer to reconstruct just 26.5 milliseconds of merging. Okay, and the consequences. Now, I should say that while for long number of birds we have the smoking gun for the progenitors, we know that they are very massive stars, okay? We see the supernova, so we know that it is the progenitors of long duration number of birds is a very massive star. For short duration number of birds, there is no such smoking gun, okay? However, there would be some possibilities in this. Mergers are expected to produce between 10 to minus 3 and 10 to minus 1 solar mass of material in of ejecta, which are roughly isotropic and are super relativistic. Okay? So no problem with jets with reducing beam. No. These ejecta are of course neutron rich. Undergo our process of nucleosynthesis. Indeed, we think that most hard elements in our universe are formed in this kind of mergers. Okay. For example, gold is an element which is produced by our process. Probably, it was produced in this kind of mergers. However, the early formed our elements are unstable and radioactive. Okay, so they undergo radioactive decay, and this radioactive decay heats the ejector and make them emit thermal radiation. Okay, just like happens for supernova, where nickel, radioactive nickel powers the supernova emission. Here the emission is powered by this R. I hope you remember the R stands is for rapid, okay, elements. So we have thermal isotropic radiation expected a few days after the short gamma burst. If it is powered by neutron star mergers or neutron star black hole. Now calculating exactly the luminosity of this the source, which are named kilonove because the luminosity is about 1,000 luminosity of a nova, but it's 1,000 times less the luminosity of a copper galaxy. The typical luminosity is expected to be magnitude 22 in the I band two days after the trigger. But this is a young field of research, and developments are being made almost every month. There is a paper showing new light curves for field novel. The reason is there is a very strong opacity from these R elements, and the opacity of R elements is not known properly. Okay, they are strange elements, the rare Earth elements, and the opacity of these ions is not clear. However, most of the time we think that this is the luminosity of Kirchhoff. Have we seen them? Is Kirchhoff probably yes? This is the host galaxy of the gamma member of the short gamma burst 13.06 or 63B. Okay? Seen by Hubble Space Telescope. 10 days after the event. This is in the far infrared, in the near infrared, in H band. Okay? The peak is expected to be late if you observe a near infrared. Okay? This was the location of the short gamma burst. HST took another shot 20 days later, and the source here was vanished. This was the afterglow. No, it was not the afterglow, because this is the light curves of the optical afterglow of the gamma burst. As you can see, it was going down already a few days after the trigger. The luminosity of this source here was way above the prediction of the optical afterglow. And so we think it was the kilonova. This is the expected luminosity for a kilonova of zero, which has emitted 0.01 solar mass material. This is for 0.1. So data can be reconciled, can make observations if the mass of the ejecta was of the order of 0.05 solar mass. Okay. Another important. So I should say that these days we have more of these observations, but again, it is not 100% sure that this is the real phenomenon. Because, we have seen strange behaviors from gamma burst afterglows, and here, more importantly, we have only one data point, which is not enough. However, we have seen it's not strong enough to give you a confident discovery. Okay? However, these days we have studied the light curves of other short gamma bursts, and we see that at late epochs, several days, weeks after the jiggers, there are excess in their light curves, okay? Which can be explained if there is a kilonova there. The excess of emission is produced by kilonova. A second smoking gun to identify the progenitors of short gamma burst is to detect a gravitational wave GRB signal simultaneous to a short gamma burst event. During the final phases of the merger, two neutron stars of neutron star black hole system emit something like 10 to 51 Hz per second of gravitational wave radiation. Okay? And gravitational wave telescopes such as Advanced LIGO, Advanced Virgo, and the future Gabra and Indigo will detect such an emission up to 300 megaparsec distance. So if a short gamma burst occurs between 300 megaparsec distance, if we detect a very short term, burst, and we see within 100 megaparsecs, then we should also see a very strong gravitational wave beep, gravitational wave signal. Okay, if the progenitors of gamma bursts are not just on the mind, there is a problem, there is a catch, as Americans say. No short gamma bursts has ever been visible, has ever been seen within 300 megaparsecs. However, Kinonova would still be detected. Kinonova emission, as I said earlier, is isotropic, thermal, and occur even if the matter does not actually produce a short term burst. I mean, there is no reason why each matter should produce a short term burst. If there are some physical conditions and not some physical condition not met, then there may be no short term burst. Or the kinonova, being isotropic, is visible to us even if there is a short-term reverse, but the jets, the short-term reverse, do not point towards us. Okay, so we don't see the short-term reverse. But kinonova must always be there. So look for the idea is that we should look for a kinonova in the error box of natural wave telescopes. But as many of you know, these days, the error boxes of gravitational wave detectors are huge. They span thousands of square degrees. And finding a source as weak as 22 magnitude in 5,000 square degrees is like, so they say, picking the needle in the high structure. It's incredibly difficult. Nonetheless, this kind of search is being done even these days, even right now. And even this is also taken, is being carried out even in Turkey. I am the PI for this kind of project. We use the 2B-DAC telescopes to explore at least to explore the regions, the error box, with error box where there is highest probability of the gravitational wave signal. And in the future, we have smaller and smaller error boxes. Okay, so from thousands of square degrees, now in the future there will be tens of square degrees, so much easier. The holy grail of modern physics, indeed, would be to find an electromagnetic counterpart to a gravitational wave signal. Kinonova can be distinguished from supernova. Can be distinguished because their evolution is much faster. The jet of kinonova, as I said, is of the order 10 to minus 2 solar mass. The jet of supernova at 10 solar mass. So the evolution of kinonova is much faster. Okay? And the colors are very red because of the opacity of the R elements. So here's the conclusions for today's talk. Observations of the Mendelssohn properties, the associated supernovae and host galaxies have a wealth of information about the Mendelssohn progenitors and central ending. But a lot remains to be done. The physics of these explosions is quite complicated, and it takes a lot of time even on mainframes computers. Okay? But it bears very important consequences for the near future. First, we'll be able to use longer gamma bursts. We are actually able now to use longer gamma bursts to explore the universe at redshift higher than 10. Okay? Right now, ESA, NASA are preparing satellites to use gamma bursts to detect very high energy gamma bursts produce a gamma burst at high energy to study the end universe. So you may know the Athena mission. Athena produced a gamma burst at high redshift, very high redshift, to study the first galaxy. Okay? It will have a very sensitive X-ray instrument that will study the X-ray spectrum of gamma burst afterglows, and we find the absorption lines of elements. So they will study the metal enrichment at very high redshift, okay? Redshift plus 10. The future research avenue is finding the first electromagnetic counterpart of the radiation wave source. This is something that, as I said, is being done right now, and lots of money has been put in this company. Okay, that's it. I think we are done. I'm happy to take questions. The Aligo and Abigo collaboration, okay, give you the coordinates to say the map, the sky map of the radiation wave transients they direct. Okay? You just subscribe, make a sort of contract with them, and they send you the data. Not the data, this kind of map. Okay? They say 5 days ago, there was a gravitational wave signal, okay, with these coordinates. And then we point our telescope to these regions, okay, looking for the electromagnetic, this kilonova emission energy. Then we take other exposures, say 20, 30 days after Giga, when the kilonova should be over, okay? And we compare the images. If there was a source in the first set of images, and there was not a source, the same source was not there in the second late set of images, then chances are that this is a kilonova. Of course, it can be an awful lot of things. It can be a supernova, it can be optical transient of a quasar, but there are ways to rule out these possibilities. I asked for time to carry out these observations with the T100 telescopes in Antalya. They have given me some time. Right now we are taking data, because about two weeks ago there was one of these radiation wave signal. And we are taking data, and in the future we take the second set of observations to see whether there was a source in the first set that was not present in the second set. Okay.
But the event has been already happened, so
it's okay.
We now possible.
Kilonova peaks about 10 to the 6 days, 10 to the 6 seconds after Giga. Peaks a bit earlier if you're looking at the optical, it peaks a bit later if you're looking at the infrared. Okay? But there are several days of delays between the merger event and this peak.
Massimiliano, you mentioned for the short runway bursts a gravitational wave event detected by advanced LIGO, advanced Virgo, would go as deep as 300 megaparsecs, and the fact that we don't see any SGRBs. So in the next generation, after advanced LIGO, I don't know how long that will be, like in the next couple of decades, shall we be able to go deep enough so there is a reasonable chance of expecting SGRBs?
The answer is yes. There is the planned Einstein telescopes that should go much faster than 300 megaparsecs. Okay? For the time being, 300 megaparsecs may be a bit more if you're looking in the right, at the right angle. Because if the radio wave emission is broadly isotropic, okay, but it is a bit stronger if you're looking along the line, along the normal, along the perpendicular of the plane. Mm-hmm. And this is exactly where you should see a short camera burst. If you are along the perpendicular to the orbital plane of the system. Mm-hmm. But even so, do not go much faster than 400, 500 megaparsecs. There have been a couple of short camera bursts of 500 megaparsecs, at least one. But you can see numbers are against us. Okay? Well, as I said earlier, in the future, about 15-20 years from now, we should have the Einstein telescope, which Einstein telescope should go up to 1 gigaparsec.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Indeed, the idea. Actually, the ideally, you should not, if you have a radio wave signal, okay, you start looking for the electromagnetic counterpart. It's not the other way around. Because a merger event, as I said earlier, can produce a short-term burst or may not produce a short-term burst. The short-term burst may be pointed towards you and then you see it. Or may not be wanted, maybe wanted somewhere else and then you don't see it. But the kilonovel should always be there.
Yeah.
So people these days are more interested in finding the kilonovel other than the short temperature burst. Of course, if you detect a short temperature burst and at the same time you measure the events, bingo, you will win $100 million. But realistically this is not expected. Any other question? You have not asked me whether there is a goal for a massive star which is about to cast a camera burst onto Earth. The answer is yes. There is a goal for a star, I forgot the name, which is about 7,000. 8,000 light years from there, whose axis of rotation is approximately pointing towards there. And if you followed me to the definition of long duration gamma burst, okay, Wolf-Rayet stars are regarded as the immediate progenitors of long duration gamma ray bursts. Because they come from very massive stars, they come from all type stars. They have lost hydrogen and helium envelopes. Okay, you don't see hydrogen and helium in Wolf-Rayet stars. And so, if you ask me what's the ideal progenitor for gamma ray bursts, it is look for Wolf-Rayet stars. Okay. This is an unpleasant circumstance that there is a Wolf-Rayet star which is pointing to Earth. Whether that will produce a long duration gamma burst, it is unclear. Okay? But in principle, it may happen. Probably there are lots of other conditions that must be met for some massive stars to be a lot of duration gamma reverse. There is on average one long duration gamma reverse every 100 core collapse of the norm. Okay? So long duration gamma reverse are rare events and probably require some fine tunings to the physical parameters. So do not be too scared. Plus, the metallicity of the Oscar of the metallicity of the Milky Way is now in these days is solar or above solar. So this should be enough to quench, to stifle the probability that we have a gamma reverse in our galaxy. But be worried, because paleontologists will tell you that about 500 million years ago, there was one of the major extinction in the history of life on Earth. The properties of this extinction are sinisterly close to what we expect if the gamma reverse emission, gamma emission has a internet space. Okay, thank you for talking for too long. I forgot to give you my main address. I will take the first slide. So feel free to send me emails after confession, but I'm happy to take them and answer them. Gamma reverse field is a very active field these days, okay? Tony Swift has given us lots of great material to study, but there will be future missions that will be dedicated to gamma reverse. The French and the Chinese which belong to the GRB mission, which will study gamma reverse and target events at very high ratio, okay? To study them. And in 10 years, ESA is evaluating the Theseus mission, which you study, which is dedicated again to very high redshift gamma reverse. So as you can see, lots of interesting signs to come for you young people to be interested. I would say that lots of people these days have given up the idea of understanding how exactly the gamma reverse is produced, and more practically, are looking at a way to use them. Okay? If a gamma reverse occurs at redshift 10, do not care why exactly how it was produced, but use that very bright emission to take spectra of a redshift 10 source and explore the metallicities and the dynamics of gas, study the first galaxies of the universe.
Now, what I will do today, I move on to dynamics. So we will concentrate on vortex lines, because vortex lines carry the rotation of the neutron star. Okay? And as we discussed earlier, as the star spins down, these vortex lines must move gradually outward from the rotation axis, so that the supercluster can adapt to the new constantly decreasing rotation rate. Okay. For this to happen, first the cores of the vortex lines must get the information that the crust of the star or the normal matter is already spinning down. So that requires there is going to be some force between the normal matter in the core of the vortex line and especially the electrons around, because the electrons are rather short time scales, viscously and by, you know, electromagnetic couplings. In quotes, know that the crust is spinning down and tend to keep with the crust, they spin down. So there will be a relative velocity between the vortex lines, which are spinning with the neutron superfluid, and then this will produce a force on the vortex lines. And we will discuss today how a vortex line responds when there is a physical force on it. And we will see that the resulting motion of the vortex line, vortex lines in general, will be in the radially outward direction indeed, to let the superfluid spin down. Okay, so this is what we will discuss today. All right. Now, in the core of the neutron star, there is the neutron superfluid, and the vortex lines in the neutron superfluid are magnetized. The reason is the following. The protons, as we discussed, are also superfluid. So the whole proton superfluid is described by a wave function. Okay? And its motion is controlled by the phase. At the same time, the neutrons are superfluid and their wave function has a certain phase. Okay? And now, moreover, because of fundamental forces, nuclear forces, the neutrons and the protons are coupled, they are interacting. So when you have two different kinds of superfluids with different wave functions, different phases of interacting particles present in the same medium, when you have a current of one of them, it will drag along, because it's interacting, some current of the other species. This means neutron vortex line. Around the vortex line, as we studied, there is a current of neutrons, not an electromagnetic current, because neutrons are neutral particles, but there is a current, and that current is pretty strong because it increases 1 over r until it hits the core of the vortex line. So around there, from the radius of the vortex line of size xi, the coherence line outward, there is this current. Now this superfluid neutron current drags some of the proton, superfluid protons, along with it. But the protons are charged. So the vortex line, the neutron vortex line, is actually a solenoid bobbin with an electromagnetic current of superfluid, superconducting protons dragged around because they are interacting with the neutrons. So this is the physical idea. Now this means the neutron vortex, that thing there, is a magnet. And if you go through this calculation, this is a calculation that we did with Jim Soles, and at that time he had a student in the project, an undergraduate, Langer. So we did this, okay. So now, that, imagine that column is a neutron vortex line. It's a solenoid, so there is no magnetic field outside, but inside, within dimensions of the coherence line, inside this, is a strong magnetic field. Okay? Moreover, as we studied for flux lines, a flux line has a second length scale, an electromagnetic length scale that we saw last week, called the London length. So within C, there are the normal neutrons, but the current of the dragged protons starts beyond xi and goes on up to this London length lambda. So it's
It's dressed with a fatter region. And inside this fat solenoid is a very strong magnetic field. See? How strong? Well, if this was a true flux line, the quantum of flux, we know, would be hc over 2e. This is the fundamental quantum of flux. And it has the value of 2 times 10 to the minus 7 Gauss centimeter square. Okay. In this case, you don't have the fundamental natural quantum of flux because the protons are not all the protons. They are a fraction of the protons that are being dragged around. And that fraction depends on the interaction between neutrons and protons. And this is formulated by, because of the interaction, there is a certain change in the actual mass of neutrons and protons, their effective masses, and the ratio of effective mass to their bare mass without interaction describes how much proton is carried around. Therefore, the flux induced on this neutron vortex line is not the flux quantum, is not quantized in those units. Instead, it's the flux quantum times some function of effective proton mass. Alright? But it is still a number of the same order. Because effective proton mass divided by the bare proton mass is a number of order 1. So it's not quantized. It was a more complicated expression. Or rather, it is quantized in a different unit. This thing, and that unit is not exactly 2 times 10 to the minus 7, the plus quantum, but it's a number of the same order. If you take that and divide by the London length for the protons dragged along, squared, then you get the average magnetic field, local field inside this, and it comes out just like for the real flux lines, for the vortex lines also. Within a London length squared circle, hit pi lambda squared, the average field is like 10 to the 15 Gauss. Now, why should that give you a force? Well, if the electrons have already slowed down a little bit because they are coupled to the external torque, to the crust. And if the neutron vortex line at first doesn't know about this, so the vortex line is moving in the superfluid, which is still fast because the vortex lines are at the earlier positions, which decides how fast the superfluid is. So their velocity belongs to a previous omega. Okay? So there's a relative velocity between the electrons and that line. So the electrons are moving with respect to the line. When they come to the line, they enter a region where there is a magnetic field. When a charged particle enters the magnetic field, what happens? Yeah, it will try to go into Larmor motion. But if you calculate the radius of this Larmor motion for this initial very slow velocity, that radius is much larger than lambda. So instead, what will happen is, the electron will enter the region where there is a magnetic field, will start to deviate into a circle, but it cannot complete the circle because it gets out of the range where there is a magnetic field. So what has happened? It was coming in this direction, and it has scattered in some other direction. Now, depending on the impact parameter, where the electrons are coming into this region, they will scatter in different directions. Okay. So it's a true scattering process because they have lost memory of the correlated initial velocity. So what happens is that the initial velocity between any initial velocity that tries to build between the vortex lines and the electrons will decay. Of course, the energy is not lost, it goes somewhere, but it's dissipated. And the momentum, relative momentum, is lost. Okay? Now, you can calculate this process in some detail. You can calculate the scattering rate
And this is what we did in that early work. And it turns out that the force or loss of momentum per unit time, because the electrons scatter in various directions, okay, is proportional directly, approximately, to a good approximation, under relative velocity. So you have a linear situation. You have a force that is linear in the velocity difference. Okay? Now, I will go through the arguments of what such a force does, because we have discussed how the force arrives physically, but we have not discussed what is the equation of motion. How is the motion of a vortex affected when there is a force present? We'll come to that. In the end, the final result is the force is linear, and the equation of motion for a vortex time, which we haven't seen yet, we'll discuss, is also linear in the velocity is concerned. And as a result, when you solve for the force and the resulting motion, we find that on the average, the lines will move radially outward if the electron velocity is slower than the original line velocity. So the result will be to move the lines radially outward. If that is where the rotation axis is, all the lines are experiencing a force. In the azimuthal direction, they experience a force, and they move out transversely in the radial direction. Okay? And the result is that, of course, that is that all lines are moving out in the radial direction, radially outward from the rotation axis there, then the star's superfluid is spinning down. So, linear force, linear equation of motion. The result is there's a spin down rate that's linear in the velocity difference between superfluid and normal matter. C means cross. So essentially, electrons cross everything that's coupled to the cross, even if the electrons are deep in the core of the neutron star. Okay? And this is, of course, superfluid. So the result is this. Now I'll tell you the details of what is the equation of motion. Now, we studied before that the macroscopic rotation of the superfluid is possible because there is a large number of vortex lines. And if the vortex lines move outward somehow with a velocity vr, then the number of vortex lines remaining inside is decreasing. Therefore, the superfluid rotation rate decreases. And this is a very simple argument. I won't go through all the steps. You can do it yourselves. Okay? It just relates the rate of expansion of the vortex lines, the rate of motion in the upward direction, to the decrease in the number remaining within R for any R, and therefore if number decreases, the rotation rate decreases. So that's that equation. And the 1 over R is simply from cylindrical coordinates. Okay? Now this is the macroscopic equation that tells you how the superfluid can spin down. It can spin down if and only if the vortex lines start and keep on moving radially out. This, in general, will be when the system needs to contain new lower rotation rate. That means there's an external torque spinning first across and the electrons down. So it will, this VR will depend on the difference between omega s and omega c. If omega s and omega c are the same and neither is changing, there is no external torque, then of course there is no reason for any radial motion. In general, VR will be a function of the relative macroscopic rotation rate of the superfluid with respect to the normal energy. The context I just described in terms of these vortex lines being magnets and scattering and so on, in that case, as I kept saying, the interaction is linear, but I will have another example, another situation where the interaction is different. We also study that. It's not even linear. Okay? So the point so far that we know is, depending on the physics, this VR is going to be some function. So VR is a function of omega superfluid minus omega normal. In some cases, it will be a linear function. Then you have one kind of behavior. In some other cases, it's an extremely non-linear function. Then you have different and very interesting behavior. Okay? But the context is VR has to be some function of omega s minus omega c. And that function should go to zero if omega s equals omega c, because there's no reason for radial motion of vortex lines in that case. Is this clear? And once you have a physical model to understand what this VR is, how it exactly, what kind of function it is, independent of omega s minus omega c, then you have two macroscopic equations of motion, that's called two component system. One of them is for the superfluid. This is the equation we have studied, only you have to know what this function is. Okay? Then, since it's a function of not only omega s but also omega c, you need another equation of motion for omega c. And that's easy because IC omega c dot, where IC is the total moment of inertia of the crust plus the core electrons plus whatever else in the star that is quickly coupled to the crust. It doesn't actually have to be in the crust. Okay? So that's the stuff coupled to the crust plus, so take this to this side, IC omega c dot plus IS omega s dot, where IS is the moment of inertia of your superfluid component. That is the total rate of change of the angular momentum of your system. Right? Let me just write on the angle properly. This is the external torque of the neutron star. So if it's a pulsar, you know what it is, the direction of torque. If it's in an accreting system, you know, or you have some model of what the accretion torque is, etc. It's external torque. So this is what you get from the physics. So this equation, which I write in this way, is like there's an external torque and then there's an internal torque on the superfluid. What's the internal torque? It's simply minus IS omega s. Okay, it's Newton's third law. Effect of the other part, the superfluid of normal matter. Okay? So these are two coupled equations. Once you have a physical model for this VR, then you can solve it. Give you a complete page. Now, let me go down. Now, what eventually determines VR, as I told you, is first, there's an interaction between normal matter and the vortex line. And second, when there's an interaction, when there's a force pushing on a vortex, how does it remove? How does it move? So if this was a point particle, we were doing mechanics, if I have a force, it will tell me what the acceleration is. If you consider the motion of a big vortex line as a column, and if there's a certain amount of force per unit length, of course you have to know what the force is per unit length of the line, then the equation of motion tells you. It doesn't give you F equals ma. F instead gives you a very funny motion. If the force is pushing this way, the vortex line will move in the perpendicular direction. Okay? And this is the equation of motion of the vortex line. Here is some physical force, whatever it is. Force per unit length of the vortex line will produce a motion of the line with respect to the background superfluid. So the line is sitting in the superfluid and it will start moving with respect to whatever the average speed of the superfluid is, far away from this line, due to all the other vortex lines. Okay? So there is a back flow of the superfluid. And any force acting on the superfluid will produce not an acceleration, but a relative velocity of the line with respect to the background average superfluid velocity. Such that if the vortex line has circulation like this with the right hand rule, then you say it is carrying vorticity kappa. The magnitude of kappa for our quantized vortex lines, we learned last week, is Planck's concentration divided by twice the Newton mass. And its numerical value in CGS units is 2 times 10 to the minus 3 centimeters square per second. Okay? So kappa is this. If the star is rotating and the rotation axis with the right hand rule is pointing that way, then all the vortex lines are pointing that way, and the local flow around this vortex line is also pointing that way. So we give a vector direction to kappa, and then the force will result in a motion, relative motion of line with respect to superfluid, such that Vs minus Vn, or kappa cross Vs minus Vn, will be equal to the physical force. Okay? That is the equation of motion of the vortex. Now, this is not a constant. This is a free dynamics effect. And it's a Newtonian effect, so it's not coming from something quantum mechanical or relativistic. It comes from simply this. First version is the Kelvin circulation theorem. So Kelvin observed and derived from Newtonian equations of fluid dynamics that in a fluid, if there are no forces acting in a vortex in a classical fluid like water, then the vortex will flow with the water. So Vn, the speed, the velocity of the vortex line, will be equal to Vs, the background flow, when there is no force. If the force is zero, okay, then Vs equals Vn. That's Kelvin circulation theorem. Sometimes force may not be zero. For example, if you are in a boat sometimes and you look at the wake of the boat, you will see little vortices. Okay? Bazı gibi okullarda arkadan bakarsanız görürsünüz. Biraz yavaş gidiyorsa, çok türbülans yoksa görürsünüz. So, roughly this follow the speed of the water in the wake of the boat. They go with it. Okay? Sometimes it may happen that a vortex line coincides, there is a storm in the bottom of the sea and the vortex line hits it. There is a force now. Okay? I don't know how about that.
If that happens, then the vortex time will tend to stick around there while the water flows past. So only when there's a force, this has a non-zero velocity. So any physical force on a vortex allows it to move with respect to the background fluid, such that the direction of the vortex, the direction of the force, and the direction of the relative motion obey the right angle. Because it's a vector problem. Okay? Now, how do you find this? How do you, can you explain this? That from F equals ma comes, of course, concept of kinetic energy. In a fluid flow, there's a distribution of kinetic energy. If the vortex itself is moving with the flow, then the extra bit of kinetic energy because of the local flow around the vortex, on the left, on the right, front, back, everywhere is the same. On the other hand, if the vortex is moving with respect to the flow, so Vs minus Vl is not zero, then the situation is like this. Let me look at it from the vortex frame. So I am moving with the vortex, I am in the rest frame of the vortex. And the vortex is flowing with respect to the background fluid, or the fluid is flowing with respect to the vortex. Let's say like this. Then the total kinetic energy will be obtained by adding the kinetic energy due to the one more hour velocity field local around the vortex to the background. This means there is more kinetic energy here. Okay? And less kinetic energy here because here it cancels. And so the kinetic energy flow is much less here than here. Okay? But of course the minimum energy situation is when kinetic energy is uniform from everywhere. So this will, to keep a situation like that, is like keeping some extra pressure here, extra kinetic energy here, and nothing here, less here. This cannot happen in a free system. To keep a situation like that, there must be a force pushing it back. So if there is a force, then there can be this kind of non-zero relative fluid flow with respect to the vortex, and Vn minus Vs, these V arrows, kappa, and the force are three of them. Okay? This is the same logic as for Bernoulli's theorem. Remember Bernoulli's theorem? If there is more flow somewhere, more kinetic energy density in a fluid, there is more pressure there. Okay? So it's the same thing. If you have, so you understand that. There's a famous kind of vault that uses this in classical fluid dynamics. And I saw the picture of this vault in a fluid dynamics book. It's not very efficient, so you know, they don't produce these books, but these vaults. But it's like this, you have this boat, and on the boat is a big cylinder that can rotate. So there's an engine, and you rotate this big cylinder on the boat, keep it rotating. What does it do? It creates a vortex in the area around it. Now from the background, there's a wind, and locally, there's a vortex. When the wind comes and applies a force on that local vortex, it moves. If the wind is this way, rotor is turning, so the vortex is like that, then the boat moves at 90 degrees to the wind. Okay?
So it's not as efficient as a sail, and as you know, a sail is not a very efficient thing either. So it's not much in use, but you know, it demonstrates this effect. Okay. So now, let us see what can happen to the neutrons. The first situation is what I already started telling you. In the core of the neutron star, okay, you have this vortex. This is the vortex. Vc is the electron velocity in green. Green, I showed the speed of the electrons. Okay. The force is a drag force, remember, because the electrons come and scatter through the magnetic field, it tends to make this relative velocity between the electrons and the line decay. So again, I'm looking at it from the line's point of view. So Vl is the relative velocity, and the force is a dissipative force, it will make it decay. So the force I show in blue. It's an opposite direction of this. Now, what is the direction of Vc? The electrons are moving slower. Okay? So, if this is the direction of my rotation axis and my azimuthal direction is this, the electrons are moving slower, meaning they move in the minus azimuthal direction. So the drag force is in the positive azimuthal direction. Okay? And you use this with kappa and so on, and you find that the resulting line motion in the radial direction. Okay? And mathematically, if you write the two equations, one of them is like this. F equals minus some constant, or minus some 1 over tau. Okay. Some mu over tau, because this is as dimensions of mass or unit length. It's a bunch of parameters that describe the interaction. It's not necessarily that you are counting the mass of the neutrons or the vortex. But the dimension of mass per unit length divided by half. So the force per unit length is something like dimension. It's not important. Just the force effect is just a constant. Just a constant times Vc minus Vn. Okay? I can just call this. But this same force also equals the response to the force is rho kappa times Vs minus Vn. Now, if you write the r and theta, r and phi, radial azimuthal components of these two expressions, so the azimuthal component of this equals the azimuthal component of that, which means since this is in the z direction, it depends on the radial piece of this. And the radial component of this depends on the azimuthal piece of this because it's crossed with z. Okay, so you have equations for which you solve for the radial and azimuthal motions of the line, and you can express the line motion vf in terms of vs and vc. So this is exactly page. And at the end, you find indeed that v of the line, it's r component, is some coefficient. Times the velocity difference between the superfluid and the crust. Okay. So this is what I told you at the beginning of this lecture, that the equation of motion is linear in velocities, and in the case of the core superfluid, the physical force is also linear in the velocities. So if you solve this equality, you end up with understanding that V and R will be some linear constant times Vs minus Vc. Vs and Vc are both assumed. So the star is rotating. Okay. And because the crust is being spun down by the external torque first, and Vs, the superfluid velocity, is catching on with some delay. Vs will always be a little larger than Vc. Okay? So Vs minus Vc will be non-zero. And this is Vr. Once you have that expression, now we go back to our equations. Okay, so in the end we have this expression, we have found here, and our macroscopic dynamical equations require, remember, how does the radial velocity depend on these things? So I just showed that when the drag force is linear, the equation of motion, this is called the Magnus equation, this is also linear. So in the case that the drag force, the actual physical force, is linear, equilibrium motion is linear by its nature, okay? So you obtain radial flow, which is linear, and then you complete your two equations by actually putting in the value of this thing here and writing here Vs minus Vc or omega is minus omega c. Okay? Because I have omega is minus omega c, this is again something else. It's a constant. Alright? Now, here, omega is occurs twice. So you will say that this is, even though the force is and the radial velocity is linear, the system is non-linear. However, in the application to neutron stars, all the changes that we try to understand, especially when the neutron star glitches, are very small changes. So omega c and omega s change from their what we call steady state values by tiny bits. Therefore, in such situations where there is a difference that's small, one tries to understand the dynamics of this. And now I can set this thing a constant. Okay? It doesn't change. It only changes on evolutionary time scales of the pulsar. It doesn't change on dynamical time scales. Okay? So then these two equations are completely linear and you solve them. Solutions are very easy.
and we keep using them and applying them in many situations, and Emily and I are doing it now also. So this is one situation. Any questions on that?
Fine. Neden fine?
Çünkü
ama vektör mü?
Şöyle bir
tamam. O
bir yerin radyal bileşeni
tamam.
BS ile BC'nin azimüt bileşenlerinin farkına düz oranlıdır. Zaten bu arkadaşların radyal bileşeni zaten yok.
Tamam.
Ben şey tamam. Yani şey yapması yok. Solunum vektör yazıp sağ tarafını tamam. Vermişler koyuyor. Onun R bileşeni ötekilerin fi bileşeninin oranlığı çıkıyor. Bunu yapmaması isterseniz size ödev olarak vereyim. Tamam, belki o notlarında vardır ama şuna eşitledikten sonra her ikisini burada Z yönünde kapat. Radyal bileşenlerini ve azimütal bileşenlerini yazın ve gereken eliminasyonu yapıp yani B, fi falan bir şeyleri neydi? Bunu çözdüm. Göreceksiniz ki lineer çıkıyor. Yani lineer olan bir şey yok denklemlerde. Bunun için yok da lineer çıkıyor. Buraya koyunca da dediğim gibi şunun çok uzun zamanlarda değişiyor. Oysa bunlar dinamik olarak bilgisayarlar çok kısa zamanlarda değişiyor. Çok küçükler oranında bir fark. Çok hassas bir şey. Şimdi bunu sabit alıyorsunuz o zaman tamamen lineer bir denklemleri soruyor. Onların da eksponansiyel çözümler veriyorlar. Tamam mı? O eksponansiyel çözümlerin ne kadar zamanda söyleyeceğini sonunda exponential decay tarz ediyor. Change for these equations is governed by the time constant here in the dissipative force, which turns out is very very short. Because remember, you have 10 to the 15 Gauss fields here that scatter the incoming electrons very efficiently. Okay, so the scattering time is something that we calculated in this early paper. Now there are some changes, but of the same order. So it's something like 100 times the pulsar period. Pulsar period, for example, for the beta pulsar is something like 0.01. So the relaxation time of the physical process is like seconds. You don't even observe it in the observation. Yeah, and the result is, although we have for the core of the superfluid an understanding of what it couples with this linear torque, the coupling is so effective, the coupling time is so short, that by the time resolution that you can actually observe a pulsar glitch, this coupling has already happened. So the result of all of this understanding is that the entire neutron superfluid in the core of the neutron star, which makes up most of the mass and moment of inertia of the star, actually is already coupled to the crust on time scales of, you know, 1 second, 5 seconds or something, before you can even resolve it. Therefore, you are justified in modeling pulsar glitches and relaxation to include almost total, the entire moment of inertia of the star in the crust, so we call it. Okay? And you are confirmed by this. In fact, this whole thing is motivated. Because, yes, indeed, when you then use this model, put the whole moment of inertia of the star here, then you have some other superfluid regions, which we haven't discussed yet. This is my last topic in the crust. You only take those, and that is the crust of the star. And that is like 10 to the minus 2. At most 10 to the minus 1 for some more recent reasons. Okay? And indeed, when you model the glitches, all the relative changes in the spin down rate and everything else that happens in the glitches, you can understand in a model where the superfluid that's responsible for the long time scale, small relaxations that take place a week, a month, years, okay, is only 10 to the minus 2, at most 10 to the minus 1 of the star. So I mentioned longer time scale relaxation of the superfluid, so that is not the core superfluid.
That is because we already discussed that one relaxation. Okay. Once you have understood that, then there is a remaining 50%. Now, so far we have understood what's going on in the neutron star core. There is an interaction. There is a calculation of this interaction force between the electrons and the vortex lines. That gives a very, very short coupling time. So in the end, although the center is superfluid neutrons, they manage to catch on and follow the crust via the electrons very, very quickly. Okay, this is what happens. Now, what remains is the superfluid in the crust. Remember when we introduced the crust of the neutron star, crust exists at a certain density, which is starting from right from the surface, all the way down to densities of the order of 10 to the 13. Few times 10 to the 13, grams per cubic centimeter. Whereas starting from 10 to the 11 grams per cubic centimeter, towards the magnitude, lower density. It's already huge compared to even the white dwarf central densities. You know, somewhere in the crust of the neutron star, the matter becomes so neutron rich that the nuclei in the crystal cannot hold all of the neutrons. Because nuclear physics is a symmetry between the number of neutrons and protons that can be bound. Okay. The number of neutrons can exceed by a little bit, but not much, the number of protons that are bound in a nucleus. But if the electron family energy is very high, as we discussed at the beginning of the course, then the equilibrium fraction of neutron, or equilibrium number of neutrons to number of proton ratio, is biased for making more and more neutrons. And at a density of 10 to the 11th, the number of needed excess neutrons becomes so much that they cannot be all of them kept in bound states in nuclei as neutrons on the Earth are. Okay? So the extra neutrons start to go into unbound, free, continuous states. And that happens at 10 to the 11th. So at densities about 10 to the 11, you have a neutron sea, just like you have an electron sea, the blow electrons in an ordinary crystal. In the neutron star crystal, there are blow electrons and blow neutrons, which are bound to the crystal as a whole and not to individual nuclei. Okay? So it's an extended free neutron system that coexists with the lattice. Now, the instability to go into a superfluid phase at neutron star temperatures is already present. Even if you have a very small free neutron density, though there is a neutron-neutron interaction, there will be Cooper pairs, and there will be a superfluid gap, and the neutron star, as we discussed earlier, pretty soon after it was born, cools down below the transition temperatures, even at those densities. So first step, extra neutrons. Therefore, neutrons in continuum states. Second, if you have neutrons in continuum states, this cannot be just a nice Fermi distribution. Instead, if you go into the superfluid phase, because neutron stars pretty much through their entire life, you know, after cooling, initially some hundred years or whatever, okay, are superfluid. So now we have a very exotic situation that has no counterpart on Earth or anywhere else in the universe. You have a superfluid. Okay. Of neutrons
coexisting with a crystal. Now, what do we have on Earth? On Earth we have some crystals in which the electrons are low electrons, but they are superfluid, they are superconducting. What is different here is the stuff that goes superconducting, that goes superfluid and is coexisting with a crystal is neutrons. And this system, our neutron star, is rotating. If you come back to terrestrial crystals, where you have a superfluid, these are the BCS electron superfluids, crystals. Okay. But if you take such a crystal and rotate it, you don't have vortex lines. Because we have, remember, for charged superfluids, there's a London current, it doesn't form vortex lines. So that's what makes this unique. We have an astrophysical system that has angular momentum, that has rotation, and it has a superfluid that coexists with a crystal, just like the BCS electron superfluid that coexists with a crystal on Earth. But the difference is, here, the rotation creates vortices. For a charged superfluid or superconductor on Earth, or the neutron star, rotation does not make vortices. So the unique thing is, you have vortices that carry rotation that coexist with a crystal. Now, these vortices, remember, have normal matter cores. And the dimension of this core is the coherence length, and this is something like 10 fermis. 10 fermis is the size, roughly, of a nucleus. The crystal spacing in the neutron star crust, depending on which layer of the crust you are talking about, is something like 30 fermis or 50 fermis or something. So here is my vortex line. It has to be in this crystal. It can either coincide with one of these nuclei because its size is 10 fermis and the nucleus is also 10 fermis. So they can coincide. Or this guy will find itself in between two neighboring nuclei. So this is 10 fermis, this is 10 fermis. Here is the next nucleus. Distance between them is 30 fermis. So it's pretty close. So this medium it finds itself in is extremely inhomogeneous on its own scale. Okay? Son derece düzensiz bir ortamda buluyor kendisini. Moreover, if you along the line, if you go along the line, if it happened to be in between some nuclei on this layer of the crystal, somewhere over there, it is likely somewhere to coincide actually with one of them. Just geometrically, you cannot avoid them because its direction is in the direction of the rotation axis. The crystal orientation is something random in respect to that. Okay, so it will pick up something in a sense. Some layers it will be interstitial, some layers it will be coincident. And so you calculate whether there is an advantage in energy if the vortex line and the nucleus overlap versus when they are apart. Okay? It turns out in some layers, many layers of the crust, it is advantageous if it happens to be going through a nucleus. Whereas this we call pinning. Yapışma. Okay? Whereas in other layers of the crust, it may be more advantageous
to avoid the nuclei and be in an interstitial position. That's also possible. But that's also a way of being. It's a constraint. It cannot go everywhere. So there are advantageous sites in the crystal, advantageous places, on the nuclei or sometimes in interstitial positions, where there is an energy gain for the vortex line if it goes through that position. Now it cannot make all the advantageous steps, because if it tries to bend around a lot, that also costs energy. Because to bend it, you will need to make more length of vortex line than you need. And you remember, there's an energy cost of making this. So you cannot bend just to take advantage of, you know, to have as many friends among the nuclei as possible. You know, visit everyone as you go along. You can't do that. Okay? So there are sites which are energetically favorable, but in between those sites there are energy barriers. Okay, both because it is not advantageous to be here for the vortex line, and also because if it was advantageous and it tried to bend, that will cost energy, so that contributes to the energy barrier. Okay, so in the end we have a situation where we have this vortex line, and it will. It's attracted to certain configurations. If it is in one of these configurations, it is stuck there because there's an activation energy, the Bohr. Okay? So let us first, before considering how it goes over these layers, let us first consider what happens if vortex line is pinned. Okay? So here is the situation. These black things are pinning sites, nuclei or interstitial advantageous sites. The red thing sticking out in this direction is the vortex line. So suppose the vortex line is pinned. Okay? Because it's pinned, it is moving with the lattice, with the crystal. As long as some vortex lines are pinned, they are not able to move. So superfluid has a high velocity, because its velocity is decided by how many vortex lines are there. So pinned ones keep the superfluid velocity fast, as long as they remain pinned. So the line is moving with the lattice, with the crust, and it has a relative velocity with respect to superfluid. Okay? But the Magnus equation says there must be some force to keep the line moving with respect to its own superfluid. What is the force? Who supplies the force? Here. Why is this line not moving freely? Because it is pinned. So there is a force that comes from this pinning. And that force must be such that if you put that amount of force on a pinned line into the Magnus equation, it will give you the relative velocity between BL and BS. Okay? So, if this is the azimuthal direction, and that is my rotation axis, superfluid is flowing faster than the line. So blue is Vs minus Vl. This is kappa. And to keep this stuck here and moving at this relative velocity, then you find by the cross product in this Magnus equation that the needed pinning force
is in the radial inward direction. That's the rotation axis over this, radial inward direction. Azimuthal direction around rotation axis, z direction, radial inward force.
This comes out of the magnetic equation if you do the right hand rule, of course, for that.
Okay? And this is very understandable because if there was no pinning, it would need to move in the radial outward direction. So the forces in the radial inward direction forces it to move in the spin state with respect to the fluid in the azimuthal direction. Okay? Okay. So there is some force, physical force. Now, how is it going to move at all? Well, then there is a force, or when there is a pinning energy profile, if you look at the if you have a picture of the potential energy landscape for the spinning, okay, without any rotation first, without any velocity, then of course in any direction you have this very rough inhomogeneous spinning, but radial outward, radial inward, azimuthally forward or backward would look better. Okay? Now, this is a big macroscopic system. We don't understand the physics. Even if we did understand the physics in a macroscopic system, you do not individually calculate rates of, you know, moving of each vortex against each pinning site in the nucleus. What you do instead is statistical physics. This system is at a finite temperature. Pretty close to absolute zero, but nevertheless finite. Not zero. So, except for absolute zero, at any finite temperature, any activation barrier, any pinning energy barrier, can be overcome. There is a probability of overcoming, which probability of any kind of motion, according to statistical physics, depends on what factor? Boltzmann factor, right? So there will be something like e to the minus e p over kt of climbing over this attractive e p, the barrier to get out will also be of problems. So there's a typical number e p, which is the scale of these potential Bazan barriers. Okay? Now, don't look at this diagram first. Think of this diagram. This is your potential energy, the pinning energy profile in a system that is not rotating. Okay? In such a system, there will be very, very low rate of any pinned vortex here to go this way or that way or this way, whatever way. Okay? And all those rates will just have the same Boltzmann factor, e to the minus ep over kt. None is preferred. So the average rate of vortex motion by thermal activation in the radial direction, in the x direction, y direction, whatever direction, is zero. Okay. Now, in statistical physics, when you have a potential energy distribution, but there's a bias in the system. For example, you are considering the flow of some charges or whatever in a very dirty semiconductor. And here's your semiconductor. And it is not connected to anything. Then there will be no flow. There is no reason. And thermal motions are completely random directions. So this system will have no macroscopic mean current. But when you connect it to a circuit, apply a voltage, then there's a preferred direction, there's an electric field in the system, external field. And that electric field will move holes in the direction of the electric field,
and electrons in the opposite direction. In any case, there will be a bias on the voltage. And that bias will be just proportional to the voltage. So instead of EP, the pinning energy height, for steps in the forward direction of the voltage, it's like the barrier is lowered. Instead of EP, you would have EP plus delta of energy. So EP minus delta of energy, EP minus delta, and minus delta is some proportional constant voltage. Okay? That's how thermal currents will be non-zero when you apply bias voltage. Right? Still, the rates depend on temperature and the typical sign of the potential energy and so on, but there will be a bias so that it produce a flow. Okay? Now, our neutron star is in the same situation. Because as long as these guys are pinned, they are, so to speak, metastable, because there is a background flow. Vs and Vl are not equal. Okay? And that requires the system to apply a pinning force. So any random motion that tries to overcome the barrier, okay, if it overcomes the barrier in the radially outward direction, it will release the system of some energy because it no longer needs to do work with the pinning force. So that's favored. Whereas again a random motion trying to go over this way, okay, will face an extra barrier. This way motion in radially inward direction now will require even more pinning force. Okay? So the barrier for an inward motion is EP plus delta. Okay? Now on this basis we will now calculate a non-zero flow rate by thermal activation with Boltzmann factors, EP over KT, E to EP over KT, etc. in the radially outward direction. Because there is a bias on the system, because it's rotating and all parts want to rotate at the same rate. Is this clear? Here is the expression. Suppose there is a microscopic rate of trial, like vortex sign is in this potential well, and you know its dynamics, some model will come to the next, whatever. Typically, it's a model with classical fluid dynamics that it's trying to, you know, kick against these different barriers at a certain rate. It's moving microscopically at this velocity. Okay? So the actual radial outward flow will be the mean value, expectation, thermal expectation value of motions in the radial direction. I'm only considering the radial component of the mean flow. Okay? But for positive steps, EP is lower to EP minus delta. For negative steps, EP is increased to EP plus delta. So I have plus V0 with this Boltzmann factor, plus minus V0 with the other Boltzmann factor. And that produces a sine hyperbolic. Okay? So this is the model. And this is scale. You scale the dependence on superfluid minus normal matter relative speed, omega s minus omega c, with a critical difference. What does critical mean? Well, in any potential, there is a maximum amount of force you can supply. And this is typically the activation energy divided by the length scale of this potential. Okay? In the case of ring, it's the length scale of the vortex itself, is C. Okay? So dividing that gives you the maximum. Usually it doesn't have to give all of that maximum force, it gives something less and it's enough to keep it there. But as the length builds up, the velocity difference, it has to apply more and more force. But there's a maximum pinning energy, there's a maximum amount of force. It can't supply any more force than that. What will happen if the velocity difference builds and becomes even more than the critical velocity? Then that means no way, no matter which direction you go, there's no way that this available pinning energy and the forces it can give can keep you there. Okay? Then it will unpin. It will just get released. So that's the meaning of this critical. So far we haven't discussed when exactly does this unpinning happen or not. But there is a critical value of the velocity. And this thermal activation will work at velocity differences less than critical. Because above critical, there is no average probability that it will remain critical. Alright? It's just a scaling so far. So you write it like that. Now, here, this process is called vortex creep. What is it? It is the model for vortex motion in the presence of random pinning potentials. We have some rough idea, not a lot, at least over your point of how much this pinning energy is. And the theory is that, okay, at a certain temperature, there will be a certain rate that this can move around. Okay? So this is vortex creep. Now this gives you, as you see, an extremely nonlinear dependence of Vr on omega s minus omega c. Going back down to our macroscopic dynamic equations of how to solve this system, in this state, both components of the system are evolving with the same acceleration. The derivative of omega s and the derivative of omega c are the same. And that acceleration will then be equal to from this equation.
Then either of them is equal to the total external torque divided by the total amount of inertia. Okay? Now, in that state, since the accelerations are equal, this is no longer evolving with time, it's constant, right? Because derivative of this is omega star minus omega c star. If you have a state where these accelerations are equal, this is constant. Okay? And I hold the value of that constant. In our series of papers, our tradition, we are doing this is omega infinity. Why infinity? Because okay, in such a state, this will be constant. But if I ask the question, does such a state actually obtain when you solve these equations? The answer is yes. Anytime you have two dynamical equations coupled with a dissipative force or torque, that means the, there is a force or torque in the system, effectively, that is proportional to the relative velocity, then, as you can show explicitly, any such system, no matter what initial conditions you start with, will always asymptotically evolve as time goes to infinity. The time scale is longer than whatever relaxation times are buried in this model. The system will evolve and find the state. That's why we call it infinity. Infinity doesn't really mean you have to go to infinite times, but asymptotically, the system will evolve. This is very easy to show in the case. This is generated from dynamical systems that have a velocity dependent. In the case of the linear coupling, the solution is just exponential relaxation. You can do it very easily yourself. And I advise you to do it. I won't give you more homework, but you can. If it's not already in the notes, you can just solve the solution for the previous case where this is linear. And you will see that start from whatever omega s and omega c values at t equals 0, the system will evolve, and the asymptotic situation, omega s dot and omega c dot will evolve equal to this, and the relative value is constant, and indeed for that, definitely. In the linear case, there's a very simple expression. If the coupling time is tau, then omega s minus omega c at infinity is omega dot times tau. You can show that. But what we are interested with is there is always all solutions of coupled dynamical systems, no matter what initial condition you start with, will evolve to a steady state defined by this. Okay? Now, I know the external torque. This is actually what I observe. I look at the pulsar. Occasionally I see glitches, suddenly the rotation rate changes and it relaxes, and this is what I try to understand. This is the whole objective. This is the only way I can have information on something interesting happening to the rotation rates. I actually observe this. Okay? So I won't, we don't have time, I won't go into the application. But that's the motivation. But those are only a few percent changes, and in the rotation rate of the crust, which I directly observe, radio astronomers, you know, measure the pulsar period, the period changes, they measure it, so they know what the rotation rate changes. It only changes by 10 to the minus 3 in all of these glitch events. Okay? So I take, forget about the 10 to the minus 3 fraction change. I take an average value of the external torque, put it here, okay? And put it here, omega s dot, as I observe. Okay, these things are things that I know. And then I put my model here, VR. For example, coming back here, I look at this. Okay, so I'm now doing the following. I take some average observed omega dot and ask it to be equal to roughly of the order of omega dot steady state, which is external torque divided by the total moment of inertia. So we know total moment of inertia of the neutron star, 10 to the 45, square
the external torque is, for example, for pulsars, this is simply this is the dipole radiation torque on pulsars. Okay. They are rotating dipoles, so this is from classical physics. This is the expression for torque. So you know everything there. You know the length. This is dipole moment. You can extract it. Neutron star radius, magnetic field, which is 10 to 12 plus, all numbers. You know this torque. Okay. In any case, since this value doesn't change by more than a few times to the minus 3, you just take an average value. This is observed. Okay? So that explanation is just to tell you we understand where it comes from, but we actually observe the number omega dot. And now you say that this is equal to 2 omega, which also we know from observations, radius of the neutron star, we know. Then 2V0, and we know we have estimate of this number, times now what you do is the following. This number you know, this number you know, this number is very important that we have a theoretical estimate of this. This is the microscopic velocities between tribes of coming over the barriers. And this is the neutron star radius. Put all these numbers in. Divide these into this. And ask the result you get for what sine hyperbolic must be is that less than or greater than 1. In some situations, depending on some pinning energies in different layers of the neutron star that you calculate, you find that putting in all the observed numbers and all the model-dependent numbers here leads to sine hyperbolic, the result of sine hyperbolic function is less than 1. Much less than 1. Then you say, for such a pulsar and such values of EP, this of course is very sensitive in this whole calculation. Sine hyperbolic is much less than 1, then it can be linearized. For some pinning energies, the system is linear. If it's linear in this steady state, then it's linear also when you perturb it from the steady state and it relaxes. In that case, you come back to these equations and you say that this is linear. You can linear this. Does everybody follow? So from observed numbers plus your calculations of what are possible pinning energies, and the most sensitive factor here is this because you have an exponential. Okay?
For some pinning energies that we believe exist in the neutron star, this equation linearizes. Okay. And then the set of equations become coupled linear equations with the relaxation time. Except the relaxation time that you calculate this way is much longer. So it is in the observable range. It's like weeks, days, weeks, months, this kind of thing. And then you go and look at the data. Indeed, you find some exponentially relaxing behavior after glitches, whose relaxation time increases with the range of pinning energies and temperatures. Okay? So this corresponds to something we observe. On the other hand, there are other parts of the crust crystal where you calculate somewhat larger values of EP. A little larger values of EP means this factor is much smaller with the same observed values, of course, for the same pulsar. Sine hyperbolic now is much larger than 1. Other layers of crust. Sine hyperbolic is much larger than 1, in which case sine hyperbolic becomes roughly exponential x divided by 1, where x is the omega dependence. Okay. So in the same model, it's a very rich model because we can produce exponentially relaxing behavior with the observed time scales. And in some other regions of the crust, you have an extremely, now this is the other story. So this function now becomes some constant, okay, times exponential of some other constant, let's say I keep using the same example of all constants. This is a different example again. Okay? But the important thing is this now, our equations have a coupling which is exponential in the difference of omega from omega infinity from steady state. This, if you look at the solutions for such an equation, you can solve it explicitly, but let's think of the physics. Physics is the following. A glitch has happened. After a glitch, as we observe, omega c crust is infinitely larger. And we think, I didn't discuss those subjects here, we think that it's spinning up because it got an angular momentum transfer from the zero. Actually, I can tell you why. Because occasionally, other than this creep where everything is happening below the critical omega, there are instabilities that need a lot of vortex lines to unpin, and when they unpin, they suddenly transfer out of angular momentum. So, we observe omega c has decreased, and we say this comes from angular momentum transfer from omega s, therefore omega s has decreased. So the difference between omega s and omega c has itself decreased. So becomes practically zero. Yeah, e to the minus difference between omega s and mu omega. Okay? The, after a glitch, little omega, which is the velocity difference between superfluid and cross, decreases, it's less. So little omega minus what it should be in steady state is a negative number and a large negative number. Okay? What that means is omega s dot for such regions is zero. It stops. So these regions are no longer creeping, no longer allowing this ground flow. What that will do is, if you come to this equation, if this becomes zero, that omega c dot is now external torque divided by only ic, not ic plus is. Therefore, omega dot suddenly, omega c dot suddenly increases in magnitude. Because less moment of inertia glitch, omega c dot is a negative number and it becomes a more negative number. By how much? By is over ic. Okay. And this is exactly what we observe. Then what should happen? Well, did it go on forever? What controls this? Omega, the difference between omega s and omega c. Now, as long as creep is frozen, stopped, omega s is kept constant. But omega c is continuing to decrease because of the external torque. So, for a while, after the glitch, it's like omega s remains constant, omega c keeps decreasing. And this brings you back to rebuild the steady state lag, which will start rebuilding. Okay? So this is extremely nonlinear response. And it is shown like this. So suppose a glitch happened here. This is time. This suddenly decreases, becomes a more negative number. And then nothing will happen until a time which I call T0 is some critical difference divided by omega naught, when creep starts again and is very good. This is extremely nonlinear behavior. Right? Stop, wait, go. Linear behavior is immediately start recovering by exponential relaxation. This is the scenario. And this is the image. So this, when I have linear response, linear creep, as I told you, gives you nice exponential relaxation. We observe it. We fit it. Very nice. For nonlinear relaxation, we don't see this because different parts of the superfluid that stop and go, different parts recover at different times. So it's rather like this. This part will recover, so its moment of inertia is back, and then like this. Okay? And the model predicts that most of the time, it is not stop and go. It is stop, go, stop, go, stop, go, stop, go for little pieces. And the combination is time dependent recovery with a constant slope. So it is not flat, it is a power law. Just proportional to t. That's also very nonlinear behavior. So the thing to learn about dynamical systems is, please listen to this for a moment, in general, the dynamical system is relaxing exponentially, it's a linear system. Because in a linear system, the acceleration of the rotational acceleration, omega dot, whatever, will be proportional to the linear force. Omega dot is proportional to omega dot equals minus alpha times omega minus the other omega, something like that. That's linear. A linear system solution is exponential. Okay. Whereas for a non-linear system, the solution is not exponential. So what kind of solution? A power law. When you see systems that are perturbed and that are relaxing, not exponential but by power laws, polynomials of some sort, those are non-linear systems. In the present case, we see in it, just one occasion we see this. It really waits for a while and decouples. In all other occasions, we see the next thing. This is also a non-linear. See, proportional recovery proportional to time, first order polynomial in time, is very non-linear recovery. This, the time-dependent behavior happens to be linear in time. That means this underlying system is a non-linear system. If it were responding with a constant offset, wait, stop, and then go, that's very non-linear. If it responded with t squared or t cubed, anything other than e to the minus t over tau means the underlying dynamics is not linear. Okay? So this is the end of the course. Okay? Any questions? Today was very concentrated, heavy. So we will go and work through these lectures. Essentially, to summarize, we learned about vortex dynamics. Vortex dynamics can be under ordinary drag forces, then everything is linear and the solutions are intrinsically exponential. That applies to the core, but the exponential relaxation times are short, so you don't observe that. Okay? Then, in the crust, it's a more complicated process because things spin and can go by thermal activation. Intrinsically, the solution is nonlinear, but for certain values of spinning energy, it behaves like a linear system. So there are solutions, exponential decay, unobservable time scales, and these are seen. And in addition, systematically, there are solutions that do this, or most of the time this. And all of that is an indication of a nonlinear process. Okay?